Well, folks, I can see a few people are joining us for day two of the Scottish International Film Education Conference. Welcome, and thank you for coming along. My name's Robert Monroe. If you were here yesterday, you'll have seen me talk during some of the sessions. I'm an associate editor at the Film Education Journal, standing in for my colleague, Dr. Jamie Chambers, who got COVID last week and is feeling a little bit ropey, but he will be in some of the sessions later on today. So we've got four sessions today, the first of which we'll introduce just now. This is our keynote for this morning, titled Decolonisation and Film Studies, Everywhere, Nowhere, Right Here. We have Dr. Bernica Jung and Dr. DiMarco, and this will be hosted by Mark Reid from the British Film Institute, who's also on the editorial board of the Film Education Journal. At 2 o'clock, we have a panel called Co-Creating Film Education, which is chaired by myself. And features a range of teachers and film education practitioners talking about using film in the classroom. At 4 o'clock, we've got the second of our three filmmaker keynotes with Oscar-nominated filmmaker Mike Figgis. And then at 7:30, our final filmmaker keynote with Michelangelo Framartino. So that's what's coming up for the rest of today. I'll pass over now to Mark, who will introduce this first session today. Myself and our administrator Pascal will be around in the chat if you have any questions. But over to you, Mark.
Thanks very much, Robert. Hello, everybody. Welcome. I'm very pleased and excited to be introducing Dee and Bernike because they've published in the Film Education Journal. A piece which is I think is forms the basis of what they're going to be sharing with us now on demarginalizing and decentering film studies, which is an unusual format. That's the first thing just to say about the way that they presented it in different kind of in different registers. It's an exchange of practice between North and South, between the film studies curriculum, which I guess is as is presented in the media department and in a film department. It wasn't actually the department that Bernica is in at the moment, but still, and within the context of a white discipline and a Eurocentric kind of conception of film, and all of the kind of issues around how we deal with and kind of interrogate cinema, which is, you know, for various reasons, has been marginal to the kind of the film studies curriculum, and whether you call it and treat it as global cinema or world cinema or international cinema, and you know, and all of the kind of issues that are associated with that, which still, to a large degree, make it marginal to the lives and experiences of students and to the discipline itself. So, I'd urge you to go and read it because it's a really good read, and it's kind of. It's reflexive and quite, you challenge yourselves quite a lot and look at your own situatedness within these discourses. And I think it's very in many ways it's very brave for that. So I'm really looking forward to kind of seeing you live and how you kind of interpret and present this present that kind of debate and those exchange that exchange for about the next hour or so, and with clips. And you're going to shuttle between each other, and then we'll have about 25 minutes or so for some questions and for some further conversation at the end. So I'm going to hand over to you both, and I'm going to mute and go invisible, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Mark, for your generous introduction of both Bernica and I. My name is DiMarco, and Nika and I, as Mark spoke about a little bit, we're presenting today. The title of our presentation is Decolonizing Film Studies, Everywhere, Nowhere, Right Here. And just a little bit of context to add to what Mark's already said, Nika and I put together an article in this kind of mixed media format for the Film Education Journal, a special issue, which was edited by Professors Lizelle Bischoff and Jyoti Mistry. And it's actually very newly out in the world, and we're very pleased with the outcome. It was very experimental for us both. Interesting to hear Mark describe it as brave, but it suddenly felt like we were trying something new. And dare I say, putting ourselves out there in a way, speaking about our own experiences as teachers, teaching film, speaking about our institutional experiences of not only decolonization, but difficult experiences within the institution. And we touch on these various elements throughout our presentation here today. We also, something that appears in the article, which we don't really speak about that much in the presentation, is our experience at a conference, and which was also really interesting, but kind of formed that last spark for both Nika and I, who've been having these conversations for nearly a decade now, based on our own experiences in higher education, doing our PhDs in the same place, thinking about our bodies as women's bodies, different bodies, marked by gender, marked by race. So the opportunity was really, we kind of took it up with a lot of kind of enthusiasm when we were asked to write this piece. And in the piece we use, like I said, it's mixed based, it's kind of mixed media piece. We do an audio recording, or we did an audio recording in the form of kind of podcast format, where we speak about our embodied experiences and these other elements. So the institutional elements of discrimination or race or decolonization, or what does that mean? Decolonization film studies as a pedagogical tools, what are they, what might they be? And also thinking through terms like resisting those tools, resisting those terms. And so we grapple with some of that year today. And we also wrote each other these letters, which is in the written piece. And it was a way of marking our different geographical places, essentially, Nika being in the global north. I had spent some time in the United Kingdom with Nika doing my PhD, but then left. And so on either side of my PhD experience is essentially a set of teaching experiences that are very much located in the global south, and in South Africa more specifically. Whereas for Nika, as you'll hear, Nika has kind of been in different parts of Europe and the UK over a period of time. So I'll hand over now to Nika to do a little bit of agenda setting and to kind of give you some sense of how the talk will unfold.
Yeah, thanks, Dee. So you... you already get a sense of how we're planning to do this, doing some sort of back and forth. So yeah, my name is Berenike Jung, as you've heard. And yes, we in the methodology for this article that we wrote, as Dee said, we aimed at both acknowledging the difference between the times and spaces that we found ourselves, or different locations and approaches, but also finding bridges between these poles. And so we kind of try to do the same thing today with this talk, because in a way we see this keynote as a continuation of our ongoing conversation about our experience as colleagues, as friends, So we will, to give a rough structure, we will depart from our embodied experience as teachers of these courses of global cinema, but also, you know, where we take these courses then. And then we also will speak about somewhat more institutionalized sides of this problem, and in between give you some illustrations with clips and images. And you will see that we have slightly different emphases. That is partly due to our different experience, but we always discovered also a lot of overlaps or ways in which are different and which of these topics are linked and speak to one another and can be connected. And so we hope it will be the same for you as our audience, and we hope to pose some provocative ideas, or you know, at least some starting points for a conversation. So some of the key ideas that we wanted to bring across were, for me, how this kind of work intersects with the problem of institutionalized precarity and what Lauren Bellon called cruel optimism, this kind of variation of the American dream that permeates academia. And one of these focal points is the texts and the ideas around Sarah Ahmed's books, especially the notion of complaint and what Dee described to me as decolonizing as disappearing work. So this kind of producing work that then just goes nowhere and is just put into a pile somewhere. Okay, so this is the introduction, and we wanted to start with a quick clip. So at the time of us writing the article, the Netflix show The Chair was coming up. And in The Chair, for those of you who don't know, it starts with an Asian American woman played by Sandra Oh, who becomes a chair at an English department, so the epitome of the colonial university. And she's the chair at this department for the first time, both first time as a woman, first time a non-white person. As you can see in this picture, she's almost exclusively surrounded by white people, most of them male. And it felt to both Dee and I that this show, there was something of almost like a breath of fresh air with this show, because it felt like it was the first time that this more structural issue that is kind of difficult to translate into popular format has been attempted, at least, to be portrayed, or that television, popular television, has attempted to portray these issues, and so perhaps even make them understandable for non-academics. And one of the things that we really liked about that was that this character of Sandra Oh's has so much energy at the beginning, and she really wants to, she has all these wonderful ideas, really wants to do all kinds of wonderful work, and is almost immediately put into place, encounters all sorts of structural boundaries that inhibit her just by having this position as a chair. And she can't really go very far with these ideas that she has. The show tackles a lot of issues, perhaps not all of them successfully, but at least this beginning, or this one movement of trying to show the institutional side of the problem, I think we found was quite successful. So we wanted to show you the intro to the show, which expresses already a lot of these things. Okay. All right. And with this inspiration, I'll hand it over to Dee now to our first part.
Okay, great. Thanks, Nika. So So this first section, we speak a little bit about teaching, our teaching experiences, and teaching different bodies, places, departments. I teach at the University of the Witwatersrand in Johannesburg, South Africa. At WITS, I'm in the Media Studies department, which is different to the Film department, a department that teaches both the making, so the practical tools for making visual material, and also, of course, the theory around film and filmmaking. Media Studies, however, is a theoretical only, we only teach the theory, and we teach across two main streams of media work, the political economy of the media, and then we also teach more cultural studies inflected work, which is really where my own research and teaching kind of lie. When I arrived at WITS, one of the courses that I inherited was a fourth year course titled Cinema in the Global South. The focus was largely on a world cinema, it was like a world cinema approach, and followed the basic structure of teaching a film according to a set of themes or thoughts or theories. Often, as is common in film studies, the films were a mix of films from the canon, often a Eurocentric canon, despite the course being titled, having the term Global South in the title of the course. There was very little attention paid to the tensions and complexities around what constitutes the film canon in kind of traditional film studies and the kinds of films that we wish to infuse this particular course with, which for me was one of the first kind of big challenges of having inherited this course. So it was kind of comprised of a mix of films from the canon and other world cinema, global cinema type films, employing examples that spoke to genre, film as text. We spoke about the gaze, voyeurism, scopophilia, all the usual suspects and other important themes in film studies. When I first taught the course, I largely stuck to the format, including the films that were taught in it. Yet by the second and certainly by the third year, I was largely provoked by broader and what I felt were important questions about decolonization in higher education in the South African context. And so felt a need to restructure this course and to present the students with other options. Many of the students were and are completely new to film when they start this honors level course, having just finished their three-year undergraduate degrees. And so for many of them, their understanding of visual texts is somewhat limited. So there's actually quite a lot that one needs to do in this single semester. Many of them are completely new to film with visual texts so one needs to think about kind of mapping some of the historical terrain and thinking a bit about which African decolonial film to teach, you know. But I also, I really didn't want to recreate a decolonial canon for this course. I also really wanted to infuse the course with a sense of agency. And also I really wanted to think about the methodology of decolonizing film or visual studies work. And for me, a lot of that also came up in other examples, not strictly film. So web series, for example, and because of COVID in the last years, also thinking a lot with streaming platforms and what we're provided with via these streaming platforms. One of them being a local one called Showmax. And so I found that I could actually access quite a lot of local material, both from South Africa and from the continent more broadly. Which was also really interesting because, of course, teaching in COVID has presented its own kind of decolonial challenges and has asked us to have decolonial strategies in a place like South Africa where many of our students do not have access, you know, to kind of basic things, water, electricity, and so expecting them to have access to a streaming facility or a device or even access to the internet, you know, all these things come with their own kind of challenges around access and agency. So I employed a number of different texts that allow students to think with questions of gender diversity, race, transformation, in racialized ways, but also thinking about the Black experience. What does it mean to really centralize a Black experience when we're watching things, right? And so I've presented them with a host of things, some one of which I'll share with you later on today. But films like Rafiki, a 2018 Kenyan film directed by Wanuri Kahui, and Ingleba, a 2017 film by South African John Tengrove. Both films were banned in their respective countries, primarily because of the representations of queer and LGBTIQ narratives. And I've also really had to think about introducing, or what it means to introduce students to films from other parts of the world that privilege a narrative that is not, as bell hooks articulated, you know, one that is a very white kind of patriarchal narrative, or having that as its central focus, and or what Hooks conceives of in her work as the oppositional filmic gaze. And this is, work from her 1993 article, The Oppositional Gaze. So my intentions with the course have been, for the going on 5 years that I've taught the same course, to introduce students to films and visual material outside of hegemonic Hollywood, outside of the hegemonic Hollywood lens, and to purposefully interrupt mainstream ways of viewing and watching. Yesterday marked the anniversary of the student uprisings in 1976 in South Africa, June 16th. A commemoration of the Soweto uprisings. These uprisings occurred in response to the apartheid government strategies of separatist learning and living. All Black school children were to be taught in Afrikaans, and on this day, June 16th, they protested against this. The government responded violently with guns, some of the over 10,000 student protesters, school-going children, were killed that day. Famous images of Hector Peterson, a 13-year-old boy, are familiar the world over as a reminder of the violence of colonial education in South Africa. In a close reflection on education in this country, since the removal, as you all probably know about, of the Cecil John Rhodes statue on April 9th, 2015, at the University of Cape Town, Neeli Kajaya Wardan explores some of these moments, the moments of dissident student bodies since that monumental period in 2015 through to about 2 years ago, when COVID halted much of our normal ways of being. She uses the work of visual artist Kimang Waliulere, specifically the work from a show of his called The Knife Eats at Home, which happened in 2016, and partly in response to the removal of the Rhodes statue. Jaya Wardan writes how the artist's use of porcelain dogs and old wooden school desks engages this traumatic, racialized history of education in South Africa under apartheid rule and before that colonial rule. The motifs at play in Waliulere's body of work in the show illuminate larger structural breaks, issues, and fissures that started with colonial occupancy in the Cape and which still play out today, most recently seen in the Fees Must Fall protests, which started soon after Rhodes Must Fall at UCT in 2015 and has extended into every single year since then. And so to just share with you, since 2015, at the start of our academic year, which is usually in February of each year, we have student protests around the country about fees and about free access to education. and so this has kind of become relatively commonplace in our universities. And so there is much more to be said about these moments and how we can approach this. We may think about a clear and linear way of, you know, what happened, what exactly happened. So formal apartheid, Hendrik Verwoerd's institution of separatist racial learning, the end of apartheid, the long post-apartheid moment, which we find ourselves in now. And these kind of make up an archive, a kind of mapping, right? Which I'd like to think about as a decolonial mapping, but is of course, you know, that rhetoric is way more complicated than a simple mapping. And so what I'm really trying to get across is that these students, the image you see on your screen now is of the 76, the school children in 1976. there's a kind of palimpsestic context in which we live, right? And so I wish to share a clip now of the April 9th, 2015 moment, the moment of the Rhodes statue being removed from its plinth at UCT, keeping in mind that some of the songs and the noise that you hear in the background, or not in the background, but which you'll hear in the clip. So the students at UCT singing, saying, you know, remove that thing, etc. Those songs, actually, those songs, hymns, some of them were hymns, are a kind of repetition of what these students in the 1976 image, many of them were the same struggle songs, protest hymns, protest music. And so there's been a lot of kind of thinking around what it means for us to be hearing these same sounds generations later. Nika, I think, before we move on, sorry, just to say these are images of Waliuleri's work. These are the porcelain dogs. And they're kind of, they're placed, as you can see, on these wooden structures. And these are the tops of school desks. And what he's done is he's reconstructed these blackboards, essentially, which you would find in a classroom. Just very interesting to think about how he's placed these dogs, these objects, essentially, looking at these chalkboards, unable to take in what is there, and how he brings in this element of erasure, black erasure, the ephemerality, also expressed through the scratching out of the chalk on the boards. Something that he speaks about, and that also Jaya Wardan picks up on, is the markings on the wooden desk. And I'm sure this is common the world over, but you know, children, school children mark their desks with their names or with whatever, I was here, you know, whatever it is, these childhood sensibilities, if one can call it that. And it's interesting to draw that through as a thread. There are two more images of the same thing, which I'm happy to speak about more in the question and answer session if anybody wants to. But perhaps just to say one more thing, which is the image on the right hand side of my screen of the school shoes, where Waliuleri has placed a little girl's school shoes on a swing. This particular kind of curation, you know, a lot of it is in kind of dialogue with the past, the 1976 June 16th experience, but also with what happened in 2015 with the removal of the Rhodes statue and Fees Must Fall. Just to say that the school shoes, that this one in particular, you know, speaks back to that 1976 moment of the school-going children. Okay, thank you, Nika. I think we can.
Okay.
No worries, sure. So much.
Thank you.
Did you want to say something final about it, or should I take it from here?
No, you can go ahead. I can, speak to it a bit more later on.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, thank you for the second, super powerful clip. Yeah, this was from 9th April 2015. Oops, okay. So I have a short preamble to sort of localize why I speak about myself today, and also why I speak about myself in the article that we wrote. As Dee said at the beginning, when we started this project, we said we really wanted to bring our lived, embodied, vulnerable experience to the table. And we felt really tired of doing this kind of emotional work, and at the same time having this emotional work and our bodies always being sidelined and being considered irrelevant to the discourse within and about the discipline or these disciplines. And speaking about how this work makes us feel, we felt was always implied to be somehow unprofessional, perhaps too emotional, too feminine, or in Sarah Ahmed's words, being heard as making a tiresome complaint or being a killjoy. That's a concept that I think Dee will elaborate a bit more on later. And so in the article, we really wanted to include us and our friendship and our experience teaching film and media and talk about the things we share and also the differences between us. And so when I speak about myself, it's in the spirit of this project. But it's also because I really believe that decolonizing is an issue that should involve and concern all of us ethically, intellectually, as an issue of justice. One of my heroes, so to speak, Paulo Freire, wrote about the pedagogy of liberation, that the pursuit of full humanity cannot be carried out in isolation or individualism, but only in fellowship and solidarity. And therefore it cannot unfold in the antagonistic relations between oppressor and oppressed. That's perhaps a slightly more binary formulation rather than an intersectional one, but I feel like he really points out that this process should involve everyone, people with bodies like mine, people with bodies different from mine. And another quote in this context that I have here as part of this preamble is from Usha Aya, from a wonderful piece of Pedagogy of Reparation. I'm going to quote a bit more on this later, where she says that basically that white Euro-Americans and their traditions need to be de-imperialized by white Euro-Americans rather than make this the labor of their critics. Okay, so end of preamble. Now on to my experience of teaching these classes in the Global North. So I have taught classes on world cinema, global cinema, transnational cinema, the different names for this, and this difficulty of naming that class is in itself interesting. So I have taught such classes in Germany, in the Netherlands, and at two UK universities in the last 8 years. And in addition to world cinema classes, I've always also made sure to teach basic film modules such as context or film analysis with an eye to representation including global films or non-Western films. For instance, you can teach authorship with Spike Lee. You can teach neorealism with Iranian cinema, or camera work with the French female filmmaker Claire Denis, or with Sean Baker's Tangerine, which is a film about transgender sex workers that is filmed on an iPhone. You can use Richard Dye's article on whiteness when whiteness and lighting, when you teach cinematography, et cetera. Another example would be a film that challenges the dominant European political discourse on migration, such as Gianfranco Rosi's Fire at Sea, which you see a screenshot here. And that film proposes an understanding of cultures as more entangled than having these separate histories. And so it poses really interesting questions also about global and local, et cetera. And that's a film that also locates such questions in the contemporaneous reality and space of many of my students in the Global North, and challenges this kind of over there idea. However, in my experience, it's not very common that films and texts are constructed with an eye to either representational aspects around race, gender, sexuality, nor further going questions, at least not when teaching aesthetics and history. And instead, it's confined to these kind of optional extra modules. And so in our article, I was very much motivated by my reflection on the place and necessity of these world cinema, global cinema classes in the film studies curriculum, especially in the global north, because that's where my experience was. So based on teaching these modules in different countries and departments, and from there on, my reflections then branched out to some additional issues. So in world cinema classes, we're typically thinking about mapping, about center and periphery, about how film is one of the many dispositifs of knowledge that creates our idea of reality, of hierarchies, of normativity, et cetera. And Dee said great things about maps and how they are can be ephemeral, et cetera. But in my classes, we start with a more basic reflection on maps as this kind of epistemic tool of normalization of what is up, what is down, what is important, et cetera. And we try to move from a center periphery, so the West versus the rest approach, towards a more polycentric concept of the cinemas of the world. And ideally, this would show cinemas also as being more connected rather than positioning comparative histories that are in themselves quite essentialist. So if they are done well, such classes are also supposed to question this to some degree, at least the conservative Eurocentric roots of the film studies degree and curriculum, rather than offering this kind of tourist or buffet approach to cinemas of the rest of the world that outside or other than Western cinema. But sometimes it's not always done this way. But if it is done this way, it is obviously a step forward from what Colonel West aptly called the worst of academic pluralist ideology, this kind of infamous 1 week about race, women, minorities that is tacked onto the main body of the canon. And what West here suggests several decades ago was that what is needed is a wholesome reconsideration of the canon already in place of what is considered the main body and normal. And that is what remains missing to this day. Many students coming to classes on world cinema, in my experience, are highly motivated. And I love the film and the text we discuss, and they love it too. And yet, reflecting on my experience teaching these classes over the years, I really wonder whether it is the students that need this kind of decolonizing and unthinking Eurocentrism in the first place. World cinema classes were at least partially designed to awaken white Western students from this ethnocentric slumber and privilege. But I feel strongly that it is the university as an institution that is sleeping or pretending to sleep, especially with an increasingly ethnically, racially, religiously, and otherwise quote unquote diverse and often socially aware student body. The original motivation for the class seems at least incomplete. Of course, on an individual level, there is learning going on. But institutionally, I feel these classes have become the equivalent of EDI policy documents, these kind of diversity statements that, as Sarah Ahmed has so eloquently deconstructed, are sort of marketing gestures that pretend to be performative, but they don't do what they say they're doing. So the classes have become sort of the incorporated critique of neoliberalism that supposedly bulletproofs it against deeper structural changes. So I increasingly felt frustrated with the position of these classes in the curriculum. Whenever I taught the class, it was an optional module, especially in often in competition to deeper theory or history modules. Often the lone class not centered on a Western canon, the amount of thought and theory to cover was potentially overwhelming. And for the degree at large, Euro-American texts and films remain at the unmarked center, presented as universal, and the blindness of the canon remain. And apropos of the canon, I want to share with you something that is a bit of a pet peeve of mine. And I know this can be considered a little bit polemic or simplistic or reductive at least, which are the films that are suggested as the best films of all times, the films that are suggested as canonical to film students. And these appear both on various syllabi of the universities I've been at and at the best of lists of the trade press. So as I said, this is a bit of my pet peeve. So I collect this and I regularly make a note of how many of these, you know, sometimes quite a lot of films, 100 films, 189 films, et cetera, how many non-Western films are included in these supposedly best films, how many women are included, and among the non-Western authors, if all of them are from Asia, or, you know, how these best of lists come to be. And I've come across many syllabi that do not contain a single film and very few texts that are not by white Western women. And so I know these lists do not tell the whole picture, but I feel like it's really telling if even educators do not put other films on these lists, don't screen them and don't know about them. And by the way, I wrote to all of these institutions and I received only one reply, which suggested to me that the problem is one of non-existence of good non-white and or non-male directors, especially historically. And that too, I found very telling because it is not that such films and texts don't exist, but that for many Western institutions, there exists little interest or perceived necessity to research them and find the networks and sources that they don't know about. And I find this is not only a question of justice and epistemic violence, but it's also a very strange intellectual blindfolding and lack of curiosity. I really find it puzzling. But it is a question of justice and violence. And it is also a question of doing the work and having the time to do it. So when I design my film analysis courses with an eye to non-Western films, I often still feel like it's a little bit cosmetic, like it's a drop in the bucket and somewhat incomplete because the majority of the methodological and theoretical texts still often remain more Western than not. But and I have another anecdote in that context, which is that in a previous moment in my career, I was told by a professor not to spend so much time on teaching preparation as, quote, the students are not important. And that was meant as good advice on how to progress as an academic, to focus on research and publishing, on networking with people above my rank. So that's another thing I found very telling. And it is one of the ways in which I feel that this issue intersects with precarity and with good working conditions. Decolonizing all film modules, including those on form and theory, should be valued and paid work, as well as a dialogic process that involves all faculty. Again, Aya writes very eloquently that decentering the white Western canon should not be the work of specific courses and faculty members, but it should permeate all curricular design to the point where we will no longer require a world cinema survey course. Okay, and here I think we go to part three and a hand back over to Dee.
Thanks, Nika. There's something quite troubling when we think about ourselves as these decolonial and post-colonial and anti-colonial workers. It's valuable, but it's also troubling, especially within institutions, and how these spaces in their structural makeup pronounce power. Historically, in a contemporary way, and how they negate people, how they negate Black scholars. Kigurum Macharia speaks about this in great detail in an article I'll quote from a little bit later in our concluding thoughts. But in some ways, of course, one of the things Nika and I are really kind of wrestling with in this piece is of course, around like these big kind of conceptual constructs, decolonial, what do these decolonial acts mean, post-colonial, we're interested in these terms. But what we're also very interested in is around the humanness, the care stuff, the unsaid kind of labor that also goes into thinking about how these on-show projects, you know, a good global cinema course, a good world cinema course, how these things are put together by people who have had to give them a lot of thought and put in, who have had to put in a kind of labor that academia, that we often don't say we appreciate or even acknowledge, right? The kind of care that goes into putting and into packaging. And in some ways that this kind of work is very vulnerable work. It's very difficult work. To go back to the description Mark gave earlier about our paper, in some ways it has to be brave work, you know, because you never actually know how it will land, nor do you know when or at what point institutional boundaries or you never know in those things, you'll come up against those things and how they may actually block the kind of work and labor you might be very invested in. And so in some ways, the kind of work we're speaking about here today, it's the antithesis of what scholarly work is, the criticality of it, because it's feeling work, it's care work, right? As shown by O's protagonist in the chair and pointed out by us here today, institutions hold these colonial and violent logics. They pronounce them word, right? And I personally, the use of this colloquial term was entirely lost on me. And one day I was at the Studio Museum in Harlem, and one of the curators there in a walkabout was taking us around. Everything we said, his response was, word. I just couldn't figure it out. You know, I eventually realized that I was having to kind of transfer or translate the single word response, which held so much power. I was having to translate that from having grown up on the likes of Fresh Prince of Bel-Air and In Living Color and all these kind of Black American sitcoms of the 80s and 90s. And it struck me that the semantic representation in the single word was very entrenched for me in particular words. And when I was thinking about institution and decolonization, that word just kept resonating in my mind. And so I felt I had to kind of bring it here today too. But the point is that in a single word, we can, in a single word, you know, in this very, there's a way in which it's said, we are aware of the ineptitudes of institutions, but we are also very aware of the power of them. We often cannot name out of fear. There are all kinds of things around what does it mean, career suicide, and so forth. And I'll speak a bit about that in a moment. And like Ahmed says, we are complicit to these forms of violence when we don't speak out, because in watching in silence, in not saying anything, we're also performing acts of violence ourselves or simply perpetuating them. So teaching in this context in which we live is a bit like this. It is the precarity of a deep awareness of the risk involved in career suicide or being called not a team player, quickly being called racist, being overly performative in your anti-racisms, or as Kwesi Gule writes, doing ventriloquism to ensure a safe space to not only create but promote and secure one's relevance in a kind of very multicultural way. Or as Charlene Kahn writes about so emotively when she discusses her own precarity after having moved to Johannesburg for a second master's, speaking about whiteness is one thing, naming people and institutions is entirely another, for which we may be punished over and over and over again. Kahn, now a well-renowned feminist professor and artist, explains how decisions made to keep talking about race led to the loss of a PhD scholarship in South Africa, and so she had to leave the country to pursue this. I want to quote from an article by Kahn called Doing It for Daddy. Okay. Kahn writes, and I quote, "The personal is institutional. The title Doing for Daddy and others like it started with the center of agency, the person joy. Amma Atta Adu's famous book, Our Sister Killjoy, was written in the same year of my birth, 1977. The novel tells the story of Sissy, an educated Ghanaian traveling abroad who ponders her relationship to whiteness, local and international, at the same time as she deliberates on blackness and Africanness, local and international. Sissy is at home, everywhere and nowhere. She is smart, witty, incisive. She's a killjoy. She cannot play the part of the happy, grateful student. One of the hallmarks is her long memory of things past. Australian feminist Sarah Ahmed harnesses Adu's notion of the killjoy for feminist and race work. Traits of a killjoy read like a classified ad. Are you lonely? Tired of the way things are? Are you unhappy in your job, your life, your family? A killjoy, Ahmed tells us, is one who refuses to sit at tables of happiness laid out by our various social circles and conventions, who questions, who makes others feel uncomfortable, who, in pointing out problems, becomes the problem. And then she continues to quote Ahmed, which I won't do. The language of being a killjoy is something that I do, and both Nika, we really found such resonance in this, in putting together this article. Doesn't Adu Sissy sound a little bit like Ousmane Sembene's black girl who travels to France only to be stuck in a house and kill herself in the bath, marking the white madam's white tiled bathroom with the stain of her dirty blood? The character of the killjoy can be found in the young woman characters of The Foxy Five too, a web series made by a third year student in 2015, a third year student named Jabu Newman. I teach this web series in my course as a radical visual form, and it makes it possible to show students that things are possible outside of the canon, outside of creating visual work marked by a good visual production or high quality production. What does this mean in the context of thinking about film education and decoloniality? It means that we do not need to compromise on the quality, but it does mean that we can think about what quality is comprised of in an entirely different way. And so now, Nika, if you would mind please playing the Foxy Five clip. And I wonder if in the interest of time, maybe we want to do a little bit shorter, and I'll just, okay.
Definition of the world's mesmerized. Yes, the way these windows are so big, you would think they were designed for white people to look at our legs all cramped up while they sit comfortably in their big-ass cars.
It hurts me most. Realizing the arts have become exclusive makes me hate being an artist.
Just fix you quickly. Now, remember, be good. Please, be good. Okay, right. Fix your shoelaces and tuck in your shirt, okay? Fuck, I'm gonna be late. Again.
How do we leave our marks when everyone is on their marks, ready to become unforgettable?
Nice of you to join us.
We're not black, we're late 40. How do you expect to start a revolution if you can't even come to a meeting on time?
I'm sorry, but can we also remember I have two brothers to look after?
Aibo, but you still need to respect us. That's no excuse. Just be on time.
Oh, please, woman, we. It's not like you're never late.
Excuse me.
Okay.
Okay.
Should I take over now, Dee, or do you want to say some things? I can't hear you now. Okay. No. I think. Yeah.
Can you
hear me? Yeah, now I can hear you. Sorry.
Okay. I just wanted to say that they make up the Foxy Five and that they are students at UCT. And that in the clip, what I really wanted to kind of get across was that.
I don't know if it's on my end, but I think your internet might be cutting out a little bit, or at least I can't really hear it. But I think we can return also to this clip and discuss it a bit more in the Q&A. So I'll take over now with my last part, which is also related to this third part on our thoughts on the institution and decolonial acts in the institution. So when I prepared for what I wanted to say, and when I thought about what I wanted to say, I found myself returning to Paulo Freire to remember why I'm actually doing what I'm doing. And so I wondered, what would Freire think of these world cinema classes and this critical pedagogy that is typically employed here? And I looked at a more recent work of his called Pedagogy of Indignation from 2004 and found this section that really resonated with me, where he writes, "There is some dark cloud enveloping present history that currently affects the different generations, albeit differently, a heavy dark cloud that in fact is the obfuscating fatalistic ideology contained in the neoliberal discourse. It is the ideology that seeks the demise of ideology itself and the death of history, the vanishing of utopia, the annihilation of dreams. It is a fatalistic ideology that, by stripping education of politics, reduces it to mere training in the employment of technical dexterity or scientific knowing." So throughout his work, Freire reminds us that the educational process is not something neutral and that pedagogy is actually always political. But in the higher education setups that I have experienced as an educator, while I see problem solving and experiential learning rather than this kind of top-down thing, I don't really see space for what Freire called revolutionary futurity. And I wonder about the role of current pedagogy in upholding the concept of education as mainly a financial investment that is supposed to produce employability, quote unquote, to streamline students to become good workers. And I also wonder then about students' expectations and demands on us, the customer service representatives of this product. Sorry. rid of the church bells. So we know where we are. I think we most of us know that the system is broken and that meritocracy is a myth. At least when I speak privately to people, they always admit this, that there are many problems with an assessment-oriented, quantifiable, outcomes-focused learning environment, that quantification turns everything into something that can be quantified into a quantifiable unit. And while the humanities might be particularly squeezed, as also the web series of the chair highlighted, knowledge in general has become some sort of commodity where students have become consumers and faculty have become content providers and the schools operate as businesses. And in this trend, decolonization too has become commodified in marketing documents and policy. And I see very little space for critical pedagogy in this prevailing market ethic where education is reduced to training, to this transference of very instrumental knowing. There's no space for utopia building and creative reimagining of the world in our learning outcomes. There's no space for the fundamental redesign of our modules and syllabi to in our contracts to include the true and deeper and full demands of that, what decolonizing curricula would mean. But this is work, and this is work that needs to be generative and planned for and acknowledged and appreciated in concrete ways. So on a very fundamental level, this is about money, about material reparations, hiring practices and funding. Decolonization cannot remain optional and outsourced to a few staff members, a few courses. Decolonizing means foundationally rethinking the entire curricula and discipline. So I want to finish with, again, with the wonderful quote from this wonderful text, The Pedagogy of Reparations, where Aya writes that a pedagogy of reparations mobilizes decolonial praxis to ask how, as educators, we may retrain our colonized visions to see more clearly the ethics of disciplinary, pedagogical, and administrative decisions around survey courses, breadth requirements, the selection of quote-unquote foundational film and media texts, the design of theory and methods courses, modes of reading, choice of dissertation topics, among others, to see more clearly who is structurally inside and outside of our institutions. And I really love Aya's formulation of a reparative pedagogy as a continued commitment to constant repair and care. So I will conclude here my part and hand it over to Dee.
Okay, thank you, Nika. So really, I will now end with a quotation from queer scholar and radical Black intellectual Keguru Macharia, and the piece is titled Black Beyond Negation. And just to say something about this kind of pulling or drawing from Keguru's work, is to say that to end on this note is really to express also, or to speak back to the methodology in constructing this piece, purposefully kind of interrogating the terms and the logics and the larger concepts, but also, you know, not as work that is about negating either Black negation or other kind of forms of reimagining the former colonized in filmic spaces and in how we teach more broadly. So it's really to end on this note, casting quite a critical eye on examples, experiences, and allowing for mental freedom and care. Black beyond negation. There might be something theoretically uninteresting about care. It is feminized work, so devalued. It is also frequently tedious, repetitive, and unglamorous work. I am uninterested in investigating, documenting, theorizing, and inhabiting my own negation, Black negation. I'm uninterested in remaining within the dynamics of oppression and resistance, oppression and agency, as the dominant frames within which Black life is to be thought and theorized. I am uninterested in the brief glimpses of something called Black agency found in colonial archives. Robust strands of African studies, post-colonial studies, and Black studies are very interested in Black negation. Black negation is not only central to disciplinary formation, Macharia says, it is an insatiable appetite. Initially an appetite for Black negation, later an appetite for Black negation with apologies. And if you are in African studies, post-colonial studies, or Black studies, you will recognize this. It is ubiquitous. We are sent to white supremacist archives to discover myths and overrepresentations and then told to contest it. And essentially what Macharia is on about, he says it is debilitating to stay in such spaces, disciplinary formations, colonial archives, disciplinary methods. And I mean, he's speaking to the ways in which disciplines themselves are these very entrenched immovable spaces, essentially, and saying how often when you wanting to speak about decolonization or kind of wanting to unpack that work, whether it's the canon, whether it's the archive, whatever one wants to name it, that there's always resistance, and that resistance often leads to a further kind of Black negation. And I think that it's really fascinating and brave to be able to name it as such, the way that Macharia does, yeah. And I just want to end on a different kind of note where he says, terms and concepts I do find useful. Lying by Zora Neale Hurston. Invention by Frantz Fanon. Afrofabulation by Tavia Nyong'o. Wake by Christina Sharp. Rumor by Grace Musila. Speculation, David Kazanjian. Wondering by Sarah Jane Sevenak. I'm interested in how we are known to ourselves and each other, all while surviving methods and disciplines that absent us. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you also from me. So this is where we end, and we're really looking forward to all the questions that hopefully come up, and we can also revisit some of the questions that we couldn't tackle more deeply. So I'm going to stop screen sharing now.
Thank you so much, Bernike, indeed. It's not where you end, it's where we all begin, really, isn't it? It's where the conversation starts. Dee, that final litany of words, I mean, maybe it's best that it's spoken, but it was like a prayer. It was like, it's fantastic. And I think what you've been picking up on the power of individual words and, what they kind of encapsulate and use it almost as a kind of incantation that, how much they can say, which it's not really about film at all. It's about language. It was so good. I'm struck again by the vulnerability, I guess, of being early career academics who are taking this on, which is kind of absurd that you, as you said, you inherit a course, you inherit a module, and it takes you 3 years before you're emboldened. Why should you be doing that work? Why should the most precarious and the least experienced, the most junior people be taking on the responsibility for this? But in some ways, it's best that you are also the best people to be doing it. It's a really difficult kind of conundrum. I love the kind of the diversity of the moving image material that you've thrown in there. I mean, the footage of Roads Must Fall, which is a piece of kind of documentary news footage, and then it has this extraordinary moment, that burns in the shot when the statue's face becomes covered in that white sheet. It's just so powerful. So even there's something kind of cinematic about it, which, but beyond the medium, it doesn't really matter whether it's in a Antonioni film. You know, it's from a piece of news footage, and suddenly that it comes alive with something much more than itself. I'm giving people an opportunity just to kind of think and gather their thoughts, and you can start to put questions in the Q&A box or in the chat, and we'll kind of keep an eye on that. I was also struck by, I mean, maybe I won't ask this a question, but just about the role of making, which I think that you raise in the that you raise in the article, and the thing around the Foxy Five, and maybe that there might be a tension in expecting students to be making representations that challenge kind of dominant representations at the same time as they want jobs in media industries, and how you kind of navigate that we're doing this for pedagogic and political purposes, but at the same time recognizing that you want skills in order to get for you to get job, you know, precarious jobs in the most kind of precarious and unreasonable of industries. But we do have a question in the Q&A, so we should go straight to that, and it's from Joseph Akatima to Dee. What may be the pedagogical challenge of decolonizing in film studies alongside increasing national demand for decolonizing education curricula in South Africa?
It's a big question.
Quite a big question.
I'm not quite sure what part of that you're most interested in, Joseph. Look, for the students, what they want, what we hear from them year after year since 2015, is that they want to see more texts that are part of an undergraduate canon, the things that we teach at undergraduate level, by scholars who are not European and who are not from a kind of global North context. And we're doing that work. Some of us are doing that work, some are not. And that is also happening for a host of different reasons. I would say that is probably one of the biggest pedagogical challenges, is that there's a great need and push for it. Of course, the universities instruct us all to have a decolonial agenda, you know, that departments need to have one within the department, certain courses need to really show, you know, this is a decolonial, we've really paid attention to our, to which theories and how those theories are being put together from a kind of decolonial perspective. But it's pretty hard. Nobody's monitoring it, perhaps is an important thing to say. The challenges are that in nobody monitoring it, there's an interest in it, but there's also a lot of kind of sidestepping how you decolonize film studies. One of the other big challenges is, which texts do you teach? What do you teach as decolonial work? Because of course, if we think about that in a more traditional sense, we are thinking about African films, many of them East African films or by East African directors of the kind of 60s and 70s. So then there's this gap, you know, so there are quite a few challenges, Joseph. The students want to be learning and they want examples and they want material and they want scholarship that they can ground their thinking in that is, that's not white, that's not European. Teachers are, it's like I say, it's entirely dependent on how you teach and what you teach and the choices you make. And then of course, what are the tools and resources you have, you know, how are you equipped to deal with those things? And then, I mean, we have other pedagogical challenges, which I kind of mentioned earlier as well. During COVID, internet access was a big one. You know, we have regular outages, electricity, you know, where you just don't have electricity for 2 to 3 hours at a time. That's called load shedding. You know, so they are, those are also structural pedagogical challenges, because it means that you might be trying to teach, but you can't teach a film, or material and apparatus has been stolen from the classroom, you know, so you can't really show the film, you know. So there are all kinds of things in the choosing of the, from the what film do you choose, or which set of films you choose, what is the theory that accompanies it, to the very kind of material structure of the classroom.
I wonder whether sometimes we get a bit too hung up on texts, on the actual text that we choose, because, you know, the choice is probably functionally infinite. You know, we could choose anything. So choose something, and it doesn't really, otherwise you fall into that kind of into the canonical default, yeah. And the kind of canonical fallacy that there is a list of great films, that there's a kind of list of best films, you know, which you have to take one step aside to realize how absurd that notion is. You know, like when somebody says, what's your favorite film, and you say, well, you know, which day are you asking me, how do I feel, what, you know, what have I seen yesterday, that, so it, and what's much harder is creating the pedagogical frame for interrogating these kind of structures and representations. Mm-hmm. What really doesn't matter is the films, you know, the actual films that you choose, and because, you know, that plays into the old structure, the old inherited structure. Mm. But what's really difficult is how do you reframe the these representations using your pedagogy. Veronique, were you going to pitch in?
Sorry, yeah, no, I also wanted to. I mean, I think that came across in our talk, but I think one of the absurdities that we also you know, realized and were working through was this idea that there is this one size fits all approach when you are in these very, very different situations, not, you know, in terms of, you know, difficulties of access to material, but also like very different student bodies with different needs in a certain way, or different things that are important and, you know, and that we can learn from the students. So even more, I would agree that it's not, I mean, that is one of the key criticisms that I always encounter, that it's necessary to have some sort of like common core, common ground canon. I would disagree, but I feel like the issue is always framed as like one of absolutes, rather than saying, okay, but we can, you know, why can't we have some sort of dialogue? And the list is potentially infinite anyways, but to enter this conversation rather than having this encrusted monolithic idea of what matters.
Who else? Has anybody else got a question? One of the things that struck me when I was reading your article, and you were thinking about, you know, that conundrum of what you do with an optional module on world cinema, and I was just thinking, maybe you use the module to reframe the whole degree course. You know, you use it to challenge the whole course rather than try and address the 95% of cinema that isn't being represented, and, you know, how can you possibly do that in a semester? But using it to speak back against the structure of the whole course, you know, another difficult thing to do. Alan is in the chat. Speaking of intersectionality, during my time as professor of film at TUT South Africa, I ran a viewing program on Wednesday afternoons. It took time to realize why only white students attended the whole film, because no black student drove their own car, had to get minibuses back to the townships. Also, why the same students were late for 8 a.m. lecture starts. I changed things with a 9 a.m. start. The legacies remain. I mean, these are, maybe you want to comment on that, but the kind of the structural, the economic, the social stuff, that underpins absolutely everything we all do, and which is largely invisible if you're, yeah, you know, you're subsisting from a basis of privilege, that you just don't see, you don't know, you don't hear what those challenges are.
Yeah, you don't. I mean, what Alan said is, that's very familiar. And to me, it's very familiar to my context. And I mean, I found that, you know, as a teacher, it's also complicated because it means there's a whole other kind of skill set that you need that you're not actually equipped with via a PhD or, you know, critical thinking. It's a more kind of pastoral role in a way, you know, so you kind of need to be very sensitive to the challenges. I mean, the load shedding that I was mentioning earlier, you know, of course one has a kind of course outline and students know when things are coming up and, but still, you know, you'll get to that point where assignments need to be uploaded and it was a load shedding day and someone was affected by it. And so you have to be quite agile actually in your responses. So even as a way of thinking about yourself as a teacher, your how you relate to the students has to be so kind of malleable, you know, which in itself, for me, it feels like decolonial methodology in your everyday, it's the everyday stuff, you know, you're actually not separated from it. Even if you're not thinking about it critically in that moment, you have to go, I can't privilege one student over another. Someone else might have a generator. Someone might have solar panels on their roof or whatever. Someone else is trying to find money to get in a taxi to get to school, you know? So these are some of the things. I mean, yeah, just to kind of acknowledge what Alan's saying. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And they're very, yeah. Sorry, Nika.
No, sorry. Just to add on to this. I mean, I feel like even approaching the student as a person with, there is a level in which these things intersect, like in, you know, I mean, I know people who have this idea of, you know, I'm a representative of this institution and like I'm sort of like an objective normative spokesman. I'm not a person, like I barely have a name, and otherwise I just spout knowledge, and you know, maybe there's some ideally only in lectures, you know, and then I don't know, it's just but that still exists, and sometimes also students still have this idea, so you also sometimes encounter the, like, you're not perhaps taken as seriously or not considered quite I find it, it's a lot of extra work that is, again, this kind of invisible work, emotional work. It's work that is also immensely, you know, can be immensely, feeling immensely joyful or productive or just important and meaningful. But it's also very frustrating to be sidelined so much in these ways.
Alice just followed up that, you know, this the students who are late were not allowed into class by the white lecturers because, you know, one of the things that we have in if you're being trained for roles in the industry, it is about being on time, and it's actually something that the Foxy Five teaches as well. You know, that they have the same respect for timekeeping. So
yeah.
I'm just picking up, Nika, on what you were saying about care and care of the students and how, you know, the advice that you were given was not to care for the students because that's not what you were there for. You were there for the discipline, you're there for the subject in your own research career. And one of the things that comes out in the article is the kind of the degree of exposure that you put yourself to when you ask students, how do you think this the course has gone, and they come back with challenge, and the challenge is, you know, you can't help but take personally, and how do you kind of manage and kind of continue to operate in the you know, being a person but also being the normative role.
Yeah, and again, that was kind of interesting because in a way it sort of instigated that, I guess, that we decided to put our thoughts on paper and you know, in a more official manner between D and I. But again, this kind of challenge that I encountered from the students, there was sort of a challenge of my body or myself, as a representative of the institution, so I get it to some degree. But one of the issues that I had with that as well was that I wrote a response and I would have liked to have some dialogue, and I got no reply, neither from the administration nor from the students. I mean, the students, I guess, you know, they moved on to other things. But I feel like that's also a fundamental, again, like I see it as a systemic problem of the university, that there are these quality controls in there, but they don't actually lead to some sort of dialogue or some sort of learning. They can be weaponized against precarious staff. People who are safe and secure don't care at all about these evaluations. I don't know. I found that very frustrating.
It's a form of repressive tolerance, I guess, isn't it? That, you know, the words are allowed to be spoken, but so long as they don't change anything materially. Yeah.
It's sort of death by busyness.
Yeah. And the students also perform, you know, they're within normative roles, you know, they're students. Yeah. And you know, they find it's difficult to enable and empower them to be people, you know, because they have to function normatively as well. Are there any final kind of comments, or I just wonder what time for one more question, if anybody's got something that they wanted to ask you. Otherwise, do you have anything that you want to close with just in the final couple of minutes from Alan? Oh, Alan's set text for first year. Okay, the five C's of cinematography. Okay, we can imagine what the five C's of, you know, that's not Claire Denis, and it's not, you know, it's not about shooting
different. That's interesting. That's perhaps the equivalent of Bardwell and film studies theory.
Yeah. I mean that this notion that you have, that you don't just put decolonizing into the optional module, but that you look at the whole foundation of the way that the subject is taught, and you change the examples that you use everywhere. You know, and it's and what you do is that you enrich everybody's experience by doing that. You know, it's not a tokenistic thing. It's not just, you know, it's not just a political thing. It is a way of demonstrating the breadth and the richness and the diversity of the discipline and of the art form, which I think you've given us wonderful pointers to and lots of great examples for. Thank you very, very much for sharing your experience and for stimulating these conversations.
Thank you, Mark.
It's been our absolute pleasure. Go off and read the article, everybody. It's the, I don't know what, you don't need the link. You just put it in your search engine, Film Education Journal, and the Berenica's names. Okay. So we're back at 2:00, I think. Is that right, Robert? Do you want to come back in?
Sure. Yeah. Sorry, I was slumped down there. Just to reiterate, thank you very much to both of you. That was really fascinating. These questions are very live at the institution where I work, where we're creating new first-year modules, trying to decolonize film history, and it's not always the easiest thing to do. We're back at 2:00 for a panel on co-creating film education. Hopefully, see some of you then. Thank you very much.
Super.
Thanks.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, folks. Yeah.